Penguin presents The Chosen Ones by Howard Linskey, read by Kieran Bew. On looking up, on looking down, she saw a dead man on the ground, and from his nose unto his chin, the worms crawled out, the worms crawled in. Then she unto the parson said, "Shall I be so when I am dead?" Oh yes," the parson said, "you will be so when you are dead." Gamma Gurton's Garland, 1784. Chapter 1, 1997. When Eva woke, imprisoned in a large metal box, the one thing that terrified her more than the prospect of her captor returning was the thought that he might not. Then she would be trapped here for good, or at least until she ran out of the things she needed most. Food, water, air. Oh my God, how long would that take? She didn't want to die like this. She didn't want to die at all. She had to stifle the overwhelming feeling of panic and face the reality of her situation. As her eyes became accustomed to the gloom, she realized she was in a container of some sort, with thick, corrugated metal sides, floor and roof. She felt dizzy and tried to focus on her surroundings so she could clear her head and begin to understand what might have happened to her. She was lying on a cheap camp bed, with no memory of how she had got there. The only light came from a single battery-operated lamp set upon a packing case that acted as a makeshift bedside table. She felt incredibly weak and had a splitting headache, which added to her conviction that she must have been drugged somehow. Had someone put something in her drink? Or did something happen after she left the pub? She couldn't remember. How had she got here? Who had trapped her in this airless metal prison, no bigger than her bedroom at home? Then there were the unfamiliar clothes. She hadn't been wearing them before. Her dress was gone. In its place, there was a thick, dark blue sweatshirt that was a little too big for her, its cuffs riding down over her hands, and a pair of loose tracksuit bottoms. Eva didn't remember removing her dress voluntarily, or putting these other items on. Someone had stripped her, then dressed her. But she must have been unconscious while it happened. She was still wearing the same underwear, minus her bra. The thought made her feel physically sick. In her fear, Eva's hand gripped the side of the bed. The mattress sagged in the middle where it had once been folded for storage. It smelt new, as if it had been bought with her in mind. That was another chilling realization. The metal box was a rectangular shape and around 20 feet long and 8 wide, with a door in the far wall. There was barely enough room to stand up. Eva tried to do just that, but rose too quickly and her legs immediately buckled and she fell back onto the side of the bed, slipped off and landed heavily on the cold, hard floor. She managed to crawl towards the door, fighting the effects of the drug she was sure she must have been given. Once there, she struggled to pull herself to her feet. When she was finally upright, she tugged on the door, then pushed at it. Even in her weakened state, she could tell it was stuck fast, locked from the outside. She returned to the bed, feeling as if her legs were about to give way again at any moment, and allowed herself to fall back onto it. Then she tried hard to remember what had happened to her, and fragments of the previous evening slowly came back to her. She had been in the pub with the girls. She didn't think she had been all that drunk. Eva had a flash of recollection, the girls laughing together about something someone had said. Then, later, they were leaving, some onto a club, but Eva couldn't go with them because she was meant to be at work the next day. Would her colleagues at the gym have missed her and reported her missing? Or would they have just assumed she had overslept or felt ill? Was anyone looking for her? She recalled almost falling over in the street outside the pub because one of her heels broke suddenly, and that she had to go barefoot, making her way gingerly along the pavement. What had happened after that? Her Her memory of the evening seemed to end with her standing alone in a street down by the quayside. She recalled walking away from a taxi rank because the queue was absurdly long. It could take an hour to reach the front. She'd been put off by the raised voices and the pushing in she'd witnessed, the kind of behaviour that always seemed to cause a fight. But after she had made her decision to turn away, what then? Rain. Rain? She had a memory of rain, hard and unrelenting, with large drops falling and drenching her. She had worn no coat that night. It had been a sudden and malicious downpour that soaked her auburn hair and drenched her dress until it clung to her. It was so heavy people were running to take shelter, but Eva was barefoot and the ground was cold, wet and slippery. She couldn't remember anything more after that. Had she been snatched in the street? Had she gone with someone willingly? She couldn't imagine she would ever do that unless it was somebody she knew, but had the combination of the downpour and a couple of drinks made her careless? Would she have accepted a lift from a stranger? It seemed unlikely. The panic began to rise again in her, along with a cloying sense of despair. Eva had almost reached breaking point when she noticed something scraped on the wall near the foot of the bed. White marks, lots of them. And she thought she understood what they were. She reached for the handle of the lamp and scrambled down to the foot of the bed, holding her face close and the lamp closer so she could be sure. Scratched into the metal wall of the box were a large number of little white lines, four verticals and a diagonal over them to indicate the number 5. 5 days. Someone had been keeping track of the days. Somebody who had been held prisoner here before Eva. Each clump of lines represented 5 days. And there were many, filling a large space that ran down to the floor of the box, then ending abruptly. Eva began to scream then. Inside the box, her screams came loud and shrill, and they went on and on, with a force powered by blind terror. Outside, they were muffled by the thick walls of her metal prison. No one could hear. Chapter 2. Jenna Ellison always enjoyed the calm that descended at 5 minutes to 6. It was just before locking up time, and her little shop was empty. Everyone knew what time she closed her doors and respected it. Dashing in with a couple of minutes to spare to grab some washing powder or a packet of sweets would be thought rude. It was one of the many reasons she never once regretted the decision to swap hectic city living for life in a sleepy village. It was serendipity. The shop had become available at exactly the right time. She had just enough money, had grown weary of Newcastle, and was more than ready for a change. The old lady who had run the place long after normal retirement age finally bowed to the inevitable, selling the lease on the shop and the first floor flat that went with it to move away and live with her daughter and her family. Grangemoor needed a shop, so the villagers had given her a cautious welcome, keeping their distance while they waited to see what changes she would bring about. When the stock stayed largely the same, but with the addition of products that proved to be popular, when the opening hours didn't alter and she continued to run the villagers' small ads in her windows for free, it stood her in good stead. Jenna wasn't naive. She knew she would always be an outsider, but she didn't mind that. As long as the locals bought goods from her and continued to tolerate her presence among them, that was good enough for her. When the shop closed for the day, she felt like she was pulling up the drawbridge, happy to climb the stairs to her flat, feed the cat, cook something in her tiny kitchen, and eat dinner in glorious solitude while watching TV in the lounge, with its bay window overlooking the village green, which always seemed to catch the last of the evening sun. Sometimes, she would venture out to the local pub, order a glass of wine and exchange pleasantries with the locals before happily retiring to a corner of the lounge bar. Unlike most women she knew, she had never had a problem going into a quiet pub alone. For the most part, she was happy to be on her own. The men who approached her, especially the married ones, were easily but politely brushed off, and she would go back to quietly reading her book. She didn't want a man. When she thought of her life here in Grange.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.